First of all, I'll give you all a view of the room. Everyone say hi if you'd like.
Hi.
And you guys are plugged into the speaker and on the projector as well. So let me just say a few words and I'll kick it off to you guys. So thanks for joining, guys. As you can tell, we're kind of doing a mix of in-person and remote for this workshop. My name is Vinay. I'm one of the co-founders of codePost. It's a CS grading tool that we're going to talk about today in the second half of the session a bit. And two folks who are leading the workshop are going to be remotely. One is Jérémie Lumbroso, and the other is James. Guys, do you want to give a quick introduction for yourselves? Kick it off.
Yeah, I'm James. I'm along with Vinay and our co-founder Richard, co-founder of CodePost, which is a CS grading tool, which you all will be intimately familiar with by the end of this workshop. And I'm going to let Jérémie do most of the talking for the first half, and then I'll pick it up for the CodePost walkthrough section, which will be the second half.
Yeah, hi, and I'm Jérémie Lumbroso. I'm a faculty at Princeton University. I met James in 2014. He was my student. And we worked on adapting, on improving the grading workflow at Princeton. So that's going to be part of the story that I tell you, and I'm going to show you how all of the lessons that we've learned trying to improve, like I think all of us in CS education, trying to improve how we do grading, trying to improve the quality of the feedback that we give students, that has really driven the process of CodePost. And that's why we were hoping to share all of this with you today. I'm very sorry, we're both very sorry that we can't attend in person. We're very grateful that you have. And thank you so much for bearing with us as we are finding this solution.
Just a quick note on process. We have some folks online, we have some folks in the room. If folks in the room have questions for Jérémie or me, let Vinay know, and then he can relay the question to us. And folks online, you could.
So we have a Slido as well, which could maybe be more convenient.
Oh, sure, yeah. Jérémie, do you want to talk about the Slido?
Yeah, it's in the slides.
Okay, great. We'll get there when we get there then.
So I'm going to share my screen.
Hang on. Oh, there's Slido.
So here we go. Can everybody see the slides?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Welcome to our workshop, Making Manual Code Review Scale. So this workshop is interactive, and as James was just saying, if you are in person, please feel free to ask a question of Vinay and he will resume the question. But you also have other options. If you are on Zoom, we will try to monitor the participants list to see who has questions to unmute them. And you can also ask a question of Slido. To be able to follow on Slido, I have the administrative settings on my phone, and I will be able to look at questions while presenting. Let me just make sure that that's true. Yes. We really want this event to be interactive. So to ask questions on Slido, what you would do is you would go to this page here. You can upvote questions, and the event code is A802.25. We really want this to be interactive. There are going to be some parts where we speak for a long while. And I know that the virtual setting is not the most conducive to interactivity, but we really want to make this as good an experience for you all. So one of the first things that we would like to address is the notion of time or of lack of time. I'm very fortunate to be in an institution that has a lot of resources, and that's certainly that certainly conditions a lot of my perspective. But at the same time, even if you have a very large amount of resources, and even if you have a very large amount of time, it's always possible to misuse that time and to misuse these resources. So what we're going to show here is how we went and tried to learn from the way that we were doing grading at Princeton in 2014, and how we've improved to something that this term I'm really happy to do and that I'm very proud of. Not to say that I wasn't proud of grading before, but it's actually become a fun part of the job. So let me start by saying, to describe, set you the pace a little bit of what grading at Princeton in the CS2 course was like in 2014 when I joined. So essentially back then we had weekly programming assignments. These are the assignments by Sedgwick and Wayne that are also available on the Algorithms Coursera MOOC. We had 130 students, 6 sections, 1 instructor, Kevin Wayne, 2 faculty section leaders, myself and Ananda Gunawardena, 3 grad TAs, and 4 or 5 undergraduate grading assistants. We had some expansive legacy autograder tests at our disposal, some of which were exposed to students. So when they submitted, during the week as they submitted, they got part of the feedback from the autograders that we got when we were grading. And the second half of the test, much more expansive, were used by the graders to diagnose what is wrong in a submission. So we would grade by applying deductions from a rubric, starting with a total of 40 points and taking them off from there. So one of the things that is very specific about our setting, but that I think that other institutions may also share, is that somebody is asking whether we could get a copy of the slides. I think we can share the slides at the end. I'm not sure if we can share them right now. So one of the particularities of our settings is that we do not give solutions to students. These are assignments that have been refined over 10 terms. For plagiarism concerns, to avoid having solution code everywhere, we have had a very restrictive attitude. So we limit the distribution of solutions. And as a result, one of the problems is that if you're a student and you have a low grade or you failed throughout the assignments, you never get an opportunity to see a solution. So we would grade on paper. And as you can see, this is our grading room on a typical Friday afternoon. And this on the side is an example of the kind of feedback that we would provide. So 39 out of 40, good code. And you can imagine that there's a -1 with a deduction somewhere in that handout. So the problems are probably obvious to you. There was a lot of paper. There was a lot of time wasted printing, stapling the submissions, and a lot of time spent trying to get a printer that would staple for us. There was a lot of time that was spent tracking the physical location of submissions, assigning them to grader, making sure that the graders didn't lose them, making sure that the students came to pick them up. And then, of course, a lot of students did not come to pick them up and did not come to pick their exams up, so we had to shred them regularly. The grading was, so here you can see a combination of things, just to give you a sense. You have the autograder output, so this is what the autograder provides after compilation of a submission, so it's a series of tests that says for each test which ones that passed. So these autograder tests were a large, sophisticated collections of unit tests And they served to assess the correctness of the solution. There was also style check and find bugs and check style to lint the submission, but there were no automated comments that were destined to style specifically. So these, this was the auto grader output. This is the rubric. So it's a 5-page long document with a series of deductions that are conditioned on observing something in the submission. And then we had a grading sheet. Every grader was supposed to report the grades that they had tallied and the types of deductions that they had applied for auditing purposes. So the process of grading was essentially meticulously applying 5 pages of rubric. The ethos of this was really about assessing the worth of the student. The message was really to make sure that if a student had done some poor code, we really wanted to make sure that they had the grade to reflect that. And then finally, since we were grading on paper and focused on the grade, there was little room for pedagogy or feedback. So many documents, tools, many authors, contradictory indications sometimes, and grading was essentially a logistical challenge. So to recap, the problems for the students were that they were getting no little feedback, and the auto grader output was often hard for them to understand as beginners or as students with only a brief introduction to CS. The rubrics deductions appeared arbitrary since no feedback was provided. Since no given solution was provided, no improvement was possible for the typical students who wasn't passing all of the tests. For the instructors, the main issue was that the bulk of our time was lost in logistics, compiling the submissions, waiting for them to compile, then printing them, stapling them, assigning them to graders, tracking submissions as they're graded, reminding graders to grade them, to deliver them on time, following up with graders who have lost submissions, pre-grading, entering grades in whatever LMS we're using, processing late submissions. All of that was a series of emails that is a full-time job to itself. Because everything is on paper, we had limited oversight of graders' work while they're doing it, after it's done. We had no limited insight on the collective work of the students besides what we could observe on the grade sheets, but the grade sheets were not always reliable. And then finally, for the graders, which may in other settings be the instructors themselves, a bulk of time was lost in repetitive work. So they were always combing through those 5 pages of printed out rubrics. They were filling in duplicate information in the grading sheet for auditing purposes, making mistakes when adding deductions up. And their handwriting was of terse comments that did not contribute to the learning of the students. It's also a hard mindset to provide graders, which is it was very adversarial. It was about finding deductions, everything that is wrong with the student's work. They had no time to read code. This was really factory line work. And there were really a lot of different parts between the grading sheet, the rubrics, the auto grading tests, the code to keep in the mind. And I think that one of the saddest things for me is that this is a submission on your left that I graded. The bulk of the feedback was this one comment. And I remember that back then I took a picture of this because I was really proud of it. It was an exhausting week and I'd mustered more feedback on that submission than on most of the submissions I'd graded so far. Looking back, I'm not as enthusiastic as I was back then.
I'll share a quick perspective as a former undergraduate grader for this course. And I remember being struck by, in my first semester of grading, how little oversight and how little room for oversight there was in this process, because of course all of this data is analog data. And so at this stage in 2014, it was impossible for someone in Jeremy's role to do any kind of auditing, just because it was impossible to query who had graded what. And drill down into how they were grading with with any speed because you'd have to manually go through these sheets that Jeremy is talking about. And in fact, the one incentive graders did have was to be effectively as lenient as possible, because the one instance where you would be called out for your work is if you accidentally deducted something from a student, which the student noticed and then challenged. And that's when you'd be called in to, you know, answer for your mistake. If you made a mistake in the opposite direction, that mistake went unnoticed because no student is going to point out that you failed to deduct points from their submission. So the incentives were not aligned in a way that led to quality feedback in the system.
I would just note that there were some instructors, some of my colleagues were very diligent about auditing using the grade sheets and had a reputation for consistency. But that was certainly not the case of all of us. So basically, our process had been first to move away from paper, to move to computers. And we did it in several steps. This process grew. We experienced with various different models. And so CodePost really started in 2014 and had a few versions. And the one that we have today is the most recent one. And today, the grading that we do in our course resembles the room on the right, this amphitheater, with a lot of our undergraduate students from the past course that we hired to grade the future course. Something close to peer grading, which is, I hear, becoming more and more prevalent in a lot of institutions, especially those that have large scaling needs. So you may say, and it's a fair point, that I'm incredibly fortunate at Princeton to have a lot of resources. But I think that the point that I hope to have made is that even if you have a lot of resources, it's still possible to misuse them. And I guess the flip side of that notion is that even if you have few resources, it's possible to make the most of it. And I want to show you exactly, in my mind, how we've tried to make the most of our time. So let's recap in fall 2014. So this, of course, has been a little bit massaged so that there's a nice comparative skill. A disclaimer is that in fall 2014, I was teaching CS2, and in spring 2020, I was teaching CS1, so the rubrics are a little bit different. But essentially, the points that I'm trying to make, I think, still holds. So in the audience was 120 students in fall 2014. There was one instructor, two co-lead faculty section leaders, as I've already said, three grad students, three or four undergrad grading assistants, and a partridge in a pear tree. No, I'm joking. So the breakdown of the time was spent, as I said, essentially in logistical tasks, or there was a lot of logistical tasks spent. So 5 hours running the autograder, monitoring its output. 10 hours printing and stapling, 2 hours dispatching to graders. So dispatching to graders means remembering who got which submission so that if that submission gets lost, you know who to query later down the line. Making sure that distribution is fair, because if you assign too much to one grader, then that really saps morale. The actual grading that I've described represented probably 6 hours across the entire staff, 3 hours of collecting the graded work. So that means instructing, emailing my graders to leave it at some point or meeting with them, making sure that everything was graded, making sure that all of the submissions were brought back. And then 2 hours recombining all of those results, distributing them into envelopes for section leaders to give to their students. So if you add all of that up, that's about 82 hours of manual labor across everybody, which represents an average of 40 minutes per student. The output is essentially a grade. We had good evidence that these grades were consistent across the class, but we didn't provide much feedback. And the time spent, as you can see, was essentially, or a large part of it, if not the majority, was spent moving around paper and being stressed about things that weren't quite working around. So now this semester in spring 2020, in the CS1 course, we have 300 students. There's one lead faculty coordinator for the grading. So here I'm only talking about the grading. I'm not talking about the instruction. So there's one lead faculty coordinator, 30 to 50 undergrad grading assistants. There's 2 hours for me to prepare a grading lesson to actually teach my graders what I would like them to do, to help them feel supported and not just provide them with a rubric, to discuss pedagogy and the kind of feedback that I would like to see with graders. That takes 2 hours to prepare. It's wonderful work to do. Then we spend 1 hour with the graders going through that, that mini lecture. Collectively, they spend about 1 or 2 hours of work in this meeting to grade submissions. We usually finish in 1 hour. I spend 10 hours afterwards writing explanations, which is something that we will go into detail. This I only need to do once per assignment. And then I spend 1 or 2 hours auditing class-wide work to make sure that the quality of the feedback is where I would like it to be and that the graders have applied the rubric consistently. So this represents 35 to 85 hours of work. It's not insignificant, but on the scale of the students, it represents 6 to 17 minutes per student. And the output here is appropriately assignment targeted explanations, custom feedback on the code, and still useful grades. The time is spent mostly reading the code, honoring students, and improving pedagogy. So somebody asked a question on SLIDU, which is when you say that I spend 10 hours writing explanations, but only once, does this mean you don't need to redo it every semester? That's a good question. Yes, that's what I mean. I mean, the explanations, you only need to write them once per assignment. And I'll show you that it's a lot easier to write them once everything has graded because you can use your students' work as examples to write these explanations and really target them to that population instead of writing in the abstract. But we will definitely go into that in more detail. Thank you for the question. So I just want to show you what, so after showing you the before, this is the current. This is what a typical submission of a student in my course, in the 126 course, which I'm teaching with a lot of other faculty, looks like. So just to preview, give you an overview, but we'll go into much more detail later. You have explanations. So you have two types of comments. The ones that are from the rubrics with explanations. So these are the ones where you see a vertical dark line on the side. So these are detailed and they're written once by me and then reproduced on every submission. And then there are custom comments that the grader leaves, which are the comment's own personal judgment. And as you can see here, it allows comments to comment specifically on the code of the students using their variable names. On the side, you can see the files. The tests of the auto graders are now embedded so that they can clearly be seen. And this is something that's much easier for the students to, there's a lot more feedback as you can see, and the students can provide us with feedback with the thumbs up or thumbs down button. So this is really, it's a lot more pleasant to be providing students this kind of return graded work because grading is a lot less adversarial. It's a lot more about really talking about code, and it makes me feel like maybe an English teacher that's grading essays and that's able to indulge every student's individual spirit. So if you now click into the grader test, students will see, have the option if you want it, to see much more detailed explanations for every one of the tests. So really that's one of the central concepts that we've developed is that if you are able to explain something once, then why wouldn't you explain it as well as possible? Since it doesn't really cost that much effort. So these explanations are used by graders to help grade the submissions and then by students to delve deeper into their work after having submitted. Can I increase? I'm very sorry about, somebody is asking for increasing the font. These are our screenshots, so I cannot increase the font. But when we demo CodePost, we'll make sure to boost the font of the screen. Thank you very much. James, do you make a note to increase the font?
Yeah, I was just going to say, as Jeremy said, this is a screenshot of CodePost. Later on, but in the second half of the workshop, when we do our walkthrough of the strategies that we're talking about in this first half, I'll be demoing CodePost live and having you all follow along on your screen, on your computer rather. And when I do that, I'll make sure that I zoom in on the relevant parts of CodePost. This is just a preview of what's to come.
So essentially what CodePost is trying to combine it in a smart, unintrusive way is what I would call the 21st century code grading toolbox. So first, through integration tools, through so one question I would observe that once you write an explanation, the tendency is to leave it alone after that, and that causes you to lose engagement with the answer, right? I mean that if you wrote it 4 years ago and need to explain it today, you are rusty. That's certainly true. I would say two things. You're incentivized to update your explanations, because if they get out of date, your students will let you know it. And then the second incentive to update it is that this is something we'll delve into much deeper. You can explore your rubrics. So, and this is something that I've done. You can see which kinds of mistakes your students made. And you'll see that as your teaching changes, the mistake that your students change as well. And you'll see this very clearly in the rubric explorer. So for instance, this term, I created a lot of rubric comments that apply to these students that know things that students two terms ago did not know. But I'm getting ahead of myself, and we'll have the opportunity to go this into much more detail. So going back to the 21st century code grading toolbox, one of the first things that we want to do is, I was losing all of this time printing, stapling, transferring, compiling, moving back and forth. One of the first things we want to do is to eliminate the manual transfer of operations from students to submission server, from submission server to autograder, and so on and so on. So we do this first by allowing CodePost to receive at any point in this chain, but also by providing an API that allows you to integrate at any point in this workflow with any legacy tools that you have. Embedded in CodePost and in your legacy tools, you probably have an autograder. So this autograder will try to ensure that student code compiles, which is so important to really talk about code constructively. It will help students avoid obvious problems, help weaker students make progress. So some of you might say, well, you know, Princeton students would, of course, they would write code that compiles. No, that's not true. Princeton students do not write code that compiles. But after a week with this autograder, because they want to have a solution that works, they engage with this autograder. They submit code until they get something that compiles that at least succeeds some of the tests. And we have office hours for them to get help while they improve for that. So with an autograder, as programmers, we all know that you can always test any aspect if you really want to once the code compiles. So it really becomes a trade-off between the time that you put writing a test and how useful that test actually is. So once you do all that you can do decently with an autograder, you want to move to a rubric. So a rubric is a way to provide direction to a human grader. It's a way to ensure consistency of grading and to decide what you want your learning objectives to be in this assignment. Above those rubrics, on specific items of those rubrics, the most important ones, the ones that align with your learning goals, you can provide explanations. Explanations are instructor-authored paragraphs shown to students that will provide the bulk of quantitative feedback received. So these are tightly linked to rubric items, and they can always be updated and modified as you improve them, and these changes radiate to all students. And then finally, the last level are the custom comments. So your graders, and especially I would say with undergraduates, they I find that teaching graders, undergraduates how to grades, but this also applies to grad students, it's really can be a learning process. And part of that learning process is to give them a little bit of artistic liberty. So I empower my graders, whether they are grad students or whether they are undergrads, to provide some guidance with respect to style. That helps every grader feel proud of the individual comments that they've contributed and not feel like they're rubber stamping a rubric from higher on up. So the custom comments are really an important feature because they allow the grader to connect to the student and back. And we have tools to audit that as well to make sure that there isn't too much leeway that is given. So basically the message there is, it will always be a question of time. Maybe there are parts of this that are not useful to you or maybe not useful to you right now. But again, my message is that I was spending 90 hours, we were spending 90 hours grading and we weren't proud, or I was not quite proud of it. Or I can spend 90 hours and feel like I'm really doing something very, very constructive, very meaningful and very fun, like writing these explanations. And being able to improve them with the feedback of students is an experience that is incredibly rewarding. And the students really appreciate that from the feedback that I've gotten. So the next steps, I've really tried to give you an overview of our journey. I've tried to give you an overview of what we've been trying to do at Princeton and how this has been shaping CodePost and how CodePost can help us reproduce this pattern elsewhere. So the next things that we'll discuss, that James will discuss, is what is a code review exactly? We know about auto grading. This is very prevalent and it's of course convenient, but what is the point of code review and code quality auditing? Why is auto grading alone not sufficient? Who does code review? Why is it essential? So we'll really talk how code review is not, as a preamble, code review is not a replacement of auto grading. It's really something that's the next evolution once you are able to get students to submit reviewable code. And then we'll discuss what kind of information can be extracted from a submission before a human grader sees it. And then I'll come back and I will describe some broad strategies that I've used in my course to scale code review, to show you how I've made the best of my time. And I'll break these down into two small categories. First, things that I think can apply to an instructor alone, even though I'm not an instructor alone. And then I'll show you how to leverage additional features to the context of a larger staff when you have TAs. So how you can engage TAs and how you can also, of course, quality check TAs. Then we will have a break. And then we will follow an interactive session led by James where you will go through CodePost and actually get to try everything that we're describing for yourself with a test assignment designed by Bob Sedgwick. And I will just check for questions on Slido. Looks like we're good. Vinay, do we have any questions from the room?
Nope.
Okay, so I'm now going to move to James. James, do you want to share your screen?
Yeah, sure. Sorry, I'm having trouble finding the right screen. Okay, can everyone see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, great. So moving on. So as Jeremy discussed, we're just going to do a quick section now, a little bit of a warm up to talk about.
Do you mind putting a full screen to increase it?
Yeah, sure. Okay. So we're just going to do a bit of a warm up to talk about why code review is valuable and why purely checking for correctness in student code is suboptimal from a pedagogical perspective. So here on the left of the slide, we have an example which I love to illustrate the value of code review. It's a quote unquote correct Java method called day of year. And what I thought we could do is talk about, maybe we can use Slido and just have folks throw out things that they see as being wrong with this code. And then we can talk about whether it would be possible to detect those things using some type of automated test. Again, this is to motivate the example of why, or motivate the question of why code review is useful in the first place. So maybe just we'll take a couple minutes for folks to throw up some ideas on Slido. Can everyone see this code?
Yeah, I see the code. It's a little small.
Great.
I think it's readable.
So someone pointed out that the code doesn't handle leap years, which is correct. Complexity of expression is way too great. Yes, I agree. Far too many statements for a relatively simple task. Far too many branches. Lots of code duplication, so lots of reuse of the numbers 31, 28, and 30. Someone has noticed a critical bug, which I did not intend to include in this code, which is that January is missing. Showcasing the value of automated tests. A great point made by someone on Slido is that this method manipulates a parameter and returns that parameter instead of making a safe copy in the method. Magic numbers. Oh, I'm being silly. January works, of course, because if we trace January and we notice that if month is one, we're just going to return day of the month. But this code is so complicated that even I looked at the branching if-else statements and forgot that this code handled January correctly. No input validation, correct. These are all great points. Now, does anyone, of all these things we pointed out that are suboptimal about this code, perhaps the only one that's testable is the comment that was made about leap years. It would be easy to write a test to check this method to see if it handled leap years. Now, some of the other issues with this code could be teased out with a good linter. So a good linter might detect the number of branches here and say something about, hey, you might consider consolidating your branches. But I think we can all agree that there's a lot wrong with this code that would be very hard to relay to a student if all we were doing was writing automated tests. And so that's why we care so much about code review pedagogically. One of the founding insights behind CodePost was this observation in the first bullet here, which is that if you look at the software engineering industry, code review is ubiquitous. It's considered one of the highest value practices. And if it's obvious why. We know that correct code doesn't equal good production code. Correct code isn't necessarily maintainable by a third party. It's not necessarily human readable. it's not necessarily extensible. And those are all things that need to be teased out with code review unless you have a very sophisticated set of test suites or in the educational setting, autograder. And also just the practice of code review within a software engineering organization is critical for building a organizational knowledge base for discussion of issues, discussion of trade-offs. And in that sense, the practice is valuable even outside of the code that's being reviewed. And just as a case study at CodePost, where spend a lot of time developing our product, and about 25% of that time is dedicated to code review. So that involves, within that 25%, we include the time that someone spends reading the code, the time that someone spends providing comments on the code, as well as the time the original author takes to process the review and make updates to the code based on the review. And that's a huge chunk of time, but we think it's really important. And skills we focus on, or things we focus on within our organization that we think are rarely taught, are writing code with the assumption that someone other than you will maintain it. This isn't something that a lot of students think about when they're submitting submissions for their assignments in typical CS curriculum, as well as just the practice of code review. So writing comments on other people's code and also reacting constructively to comments on your code. So that was a little bit of a warm up. And now before Jeremy gets into talking about some of the practices that he's developed in conjunction with us to help make code review scale, I just want to talk a little bit about some really common issues that we see when we work with instructors that make code review hard. And I would say one of the most common problems we see that makes code review hard is when students don't submit code that's easily reviewable. And there are kind of three categories we see. The first is code that doesn't compile correctly, or in the case of Python, contains syntax errors. And of course, this is extremely problematic because it means all the effort you've written to write automated tests won't be helpful in debugging the student's code because everything will fail. And if you want to provide meaningful feedback to that student, you have to go through the effort of debugging the code, which can be extremely laborious with broken code. The second common issue is that students might submit code that compiles or runs, but doesn't adhere to a specific API. That specified API of the assignment, it uses extra methods, it uses files with the incorrect name, it uses methods with the incorrect name, and this can often break an autograder because autograders are typically written assuming a certain file name and certain method names. And this makes the code hard to test in an automated way. And it also means when you're reading the code and you're reviewing submission after submission, when you see a submission that doesn't adhere to the API you expected, it can break your mental model of where to look in a student's assignment to seek out bugs or provide feedback. And that makes the task more laborious. And of course, the third bullet I'm sure you've all encountered is wacky style. So super long lines or no white space. And this means the code is super tedious to read, which means you're gonna spend less effort giving meaningful feedback to the student and more effort just trudging your way through the code. So the way Jeremy alluded to this in the in his introduction, but we've seen this method work really well to help ensure students submit code that doesn't fall into any of those three categories I mentioned in the previous slide. And this is to create an incentive for students to submit code that checks all of those boxes. And the way we can achieve that in CodePost, which we'll see later on, but it could be achieved in any autograder that has this functionality, is to, number one, create automated tests that check for those three things and expose those tests to the student at the point of submission. So that means when a student is submitting their code, they get immediate feedback. Does it compile? Does it have the right API? Does it have egregious style mistakes? And if you can attach point values to those three tests, the student is going to be laser focused on passing those tests before they do anything else. And one strategy we've seen have success is to gamify this a bit by making it very clear to the student that these tests represent level one requirements. They're the first thing you want them to focus on when they're submitting their code. And that way, you're going to end up with fewer submissions you have to trudge through because they don't compile, or because they have wacky style, or because they don't use the API you specified. So, and we'll walk through how to do this in CodePost later on. But as a preamble, we've seen this work really well to move submissions out of those unreviewable categories into submissions which are much easier to perform code review on. All right, Jeremy, I'll turn it back over to you.
Perfect. Okay, let me share my screen. So there are a couple questions that we got on Slido that I'd like to address. The first one is, does CodePost have any ability for students to self-evaluate? Imagine the ability of students to answer questions about their code and tag their code. Yes, so it's possible, as we've shown here, for students to be shown these auto grader tests. So you choose how much information you want to provide your students as they're submitting, and this can help them in their development process. A second question is about peer review of an assignment. CodePost allows peer review, but since this workshop is not a review of everything that CodePost can do, but more of a focus on this whole thing of explanations and how to get better feedback, we are not going to talk about it, but we certainly do support peer review. And then there's another comment that I just can't agree with more, which is, I think it's not only that someone other than themselves may maintain it, I tend to remind them, students, that it could also be themselves a year in the future. And I've learned that lesson the hard way many, many, many times before finally changing my behaviors.
It's a really great point.
So now I'm going to dive into actual concrete strategies to provide personalized feedback. And I'm going to try to give you a sense of the broad strategies and not get stuck in the minutia of how to do it in the interface, since you will be able to explore CodePost in the second half of this workshop. By the way, for the online participants, we will share a link to the walkthrough so that you can follow through on your end, and we will share the slides as soon as we're done presenting. So my first disclaimer is something that I said at the beginning, but that I will remind now, which is, this section will provide concrete, efficient, personal feedback workflow. So techniques for instructors alone. So I'm presenting them for instructors alone, which means that they're useful for instructors alone. But of course, you can imagine how these techniques would scale to a larger group. They would transfer pretty readily. And then the second part of this section will be specifically about things that can help leverage a larger staff, and in particular, quality check them. So even though I have this sort of artificial narrative breakdown, I wanna confess that, of course, all of this is based on my experience grading CS1 the past few terms and CS2 previously. And so this term, and specifically the examples that I'm gonna use, we have 300 submissions per week. I manage alone between 30 and 70 undergraduates. So they are all on our payroll, but any given week, a subset of them show up. And I keep them for a period of 1 to 3 hours. So the main advantage, it's not that the undergraduates are necessary, but by using undergraduates instead of grad students, we are able to parallelize the work. So it allows me to deliver the feedback to students quicker. But if we didn't have these undergraduates, we would be using 3 or 4 or 5 grad students that are assigned to us commensurate with the number of students that we have. Having the undergraduates, I'll say it right now, serves a lot of advantages, but I'll mention at least two. First, I find that part of our intro sequence was lacking in debugging and in testing. And I found that recruiting a lot of students, a lot of alumni of our CS1 course to grade the next class of students also helps them teach them debugging and testing and reading other people's code without them noticing it. The second thing is that our grad students, we are able to do a lot of creative work with them because they're not grading, and we're enabled to give them more ownership of the course. And that's really resulted in more engaged grad students and happier students in the end. So let me check the Slido questions. Is it about quality checking a staff or using a staff to quality check the student's code? Do graders have to write feedback each time manually, or it could be generative? These are good questions. So the first question, here we're about quality checking everything. We're quality checking how the staff has applied rubrics, but we're also providing quality feedback on the student's code quality. So there's several levels of quality checking, if you may. So graders, as we'll see, don't have to write feedback every time. That's the leverage of a rubric. And thank you for confirming what I said about grad students when they don't have to grade. It's the same thing for faculty. The faculty are also happy that we can delegate this to undergraduate graders. Yes, I definitely, in the interest of time, I haven't delved into all of the feedback that my graders are giving, but the kind of community spirit and the kind of discourse on code quality that I have with my graders this term is maybe not of the level of code review in industry, but it certainly prepares them to it. And for me, this is why we've made grading sort of like a teaching experience, and it's been really, really pleasant. Okay. So an important distinction that relates to the question we just had about having to manually write the feedback every time. So in CodePost, there's really this complementary notion of comments. So on the one hand, there are rubric comments. So rubric comments belong to a rubric. That rubric can be created either by the instructors or collaboratively by the staff, and that's something we'll go into. But initially, typically a grader instantiates a comment from the rubric comment. So they apply a comment from the rubric comment, and along comes the deduction, the explanations that has been set by the instructor. So everything about them is controlled centrally and retroactively by an instructor. The description that the grader sees and uses to apply the comment, so this can tell them how to apply a comment or in one context. The explanation that the student sees that motivates why this comment has been applied to them. And then if necessary, the point delta, if you want it to affect the score. But by the way, in this process, fewer and fewer of our comments have a point delta because the stake is less about ranking the students and more about providing them feedback. So rubric comments can also contain a small part that is optionally filled by the grader. So this is called the customization of the comment. So this allows the explanation is generic. It's generic. It's set by me and it should apply to all submissions. And then the grader can specifically provide the connection to the student's submission. So to give you an example, a rubric comment might be extolling the virtues of having constants instead of magic numbers. And the grader customization might specifically provide the code that the student should have entered to define the constant. Okay, and then custom comments are then discretionary comments left by the graders. So they're outside of a rubric. It's when I invite graders to use their individual judgment. And sometimes when graders apply a custom comment a great number of times, it may suggest that that custom comment should be a rubric comment. And we'll show how CodePost leverages even those situations. But these notions are important for two reasons, because they really allow you to do quality control on whether your rubric has been applied consistently, And also, they allow you to not repeat the same explanations over and over and over, and to have the efficiencies of skills. So first, I'm going to look at the individual scenario. So, and in particular, in this individual scenario, even though it's not necessary, I'm going to look at the situation where you're grading an exam or a new assignment, where you have no existing rubric and you have to create it on the fly. And we are going to describe a single instructor doing the grading. So in the next section, I will be talking about the situation where we have an existing rubric. Since I know that from the survey that you have filled in, thank you very much, by the way, for everybody who's responded to the survey. I know that most of us seem to be in a situation where we have a combination of old assignments where we have rubrics and new assignments or exams where we don't. So the broader outline of this, this subsection is to grade the assignments, we can follow three steps. So we get the submissions from the students. Maybe they are auto-graded. Hopefully they are, so that you have brought them all to a level one state. And so we're going to do code review. And so we do it in three steps. The first two steps are part of a process that we sort of broadly call tag first and explain later. And then the second is what we describe as iterative rubric creation. So the rubric, I don't know why this sentence has been truncated, but the rubric is really doing all of the heavy lifting here. It's what will enable you to have hindsight on your graded work and to both adapt your graded work and to improve your teaching in future offerings of the course based on how your students have performed on this assignment. So step one, you're going to be grading submissions. Students have submitted their work, you grade the submissions, and as you go along, you create the rubric using the inline collaborative rubric feature. So we are going to be using it alone as an instructor going through submissions, but if you had a staff, you could be creating this rubric collaboratively with your staff. Once you've tagged the submissions and you've assigned these rubric items, you're going to be able to explore your data sets and write these explanations. So that's the second step that I've described, you know, takes 10 hours, where you have four or five rubric items that are really major, and you want to write explanations, and you're going to go through the submissions in an organized way to figure out how to best explain to your students how to correct their mistake. And then in the step three, you're going to go through all of the custom comments that are left. So these are the ones that are not rubric comments, and you're going to do quality control. First, to make sure that they are not out of line. Sometimes the graders without meaning to can provide guidance that is orthogonal to your learning objectives. And you can both tell the grader and make sure that those comments are caught before they're released to students. And then sometimes the graders distributively, or you yourself, will have provided the same custom comments, and this may suggest that you could group them into a rubric comment. So step one, as you're grading submissions, you currently do not have a rubric. So as you go along, you can either add custom comments if there's something that you want to comment that is specific to the student, or you can create a rubric comment within the grading interface. To do that, you will click here on the pen, you will add a category, and then within a category, in these steps, you will add a comment, save it, and then apply it here. So here in the step three, you can notice that the comment that has been applied is a rubric comment, again, because it has that text that has this vertical line, this vertical gray line in front of it. So that's the rubric comments description for graders. And then below, you can see what I as a grader have customized it with the specific code that the student could have done to define a constant. So in so doing, you will build the rubric as you go along, as you go through your submission. and every submission is linked to the rubric comment. So you'll be able to go back to these submissions where you've applied the comment, and you'll be able to look at them when you write an explanation. So now step two, as I said, once you've gone through all of your submissions and you've tagged them, so you've built your rubric, then you can go into the rubric explorer. So the rubric explorer is really my favorite screen in CodePost. It really gives you a God's view of what's happening in your class, both in terms of how a rubric has been applied, how a rubric is being seen with the feedback column by the students, and then you can provide explanations to the students that are going to appear on all of the submissions. So the way that you do that is you click on the little button here, and then you can write a really long comment. And this, again, is the favorite part of the grading process for me. It's where you try to cobble down all of your experience, all of your pedagogy, and you try to write a comment that will really help students improve. So here, for instance, it's my attempt at explaining to students why a comment could possibly be helpful, and at least why we require them for our review process. So one of the things that we'll look at later is that all of these instances here, you can see that there were 35 instances of the submission does not have at least one comment. So that informs me, you know, I know that 10% of the class doesn't leave comment in the second submission of the semester. So that is something that I might talk about in our class meetings. And we'll see how to exploit that information later. So now step three, remember, those are the rubric comments, but there's also these custom comments. So here's how you audit them. You have a custom comment explorer where you can query through and search through, filter through all of the custom comments that have been left on a specific submission. So here you can use this to make sure that some comments that should be rubric comments. So here my example is that after grading, I found out that a lot of my graders were providing, so students were not naming their variables in any consistent way or not naming their variables at all. So my graders provided them guidance on how to use the camel case naming convention. So this seems like it would be a good use of some type of rubric comment. So you could type camel case here, identify all of the comments that talk about camel case, and then apply a rubric comment that I newly created actually for the occasion. So here I would check all of these items and apply the camel case rubric comment. So here, of course, a question anticipates the near future, which is this seems like it would be the good use for some kind of clustering algorithm. And yes, of course it is.
Yes, this is in the pipeline. I guess I'd actually love to hear from the person who asked that question what you would use the clustering for. Would it be to automatically group together custom comments that to make it easier for you to apply a rubric comment to them, or did you have some other?
Yes, that's what I would think, right? Because you'd want to give the instructors some assistance. So I'm looking at things like constructed response analysis, which is wish I could remember his name, Markrib and Lorraine's project at Michigan State, or Microsoft Power Grading, which do something like that with short answer questions. It seems, and there's also a couple projects in Germany that have done the same kind of thing. But it's a way just to make it quicker to grade things where you've got a lot of different short answers being written. And effectively what you have here with the custom grading is a lot of different short answers being written, especially over the course of several semesters where you use the rubric.
Right, and you could use it in one of two ways. One is just to cluster everything that you already know you want to tag with a comment. The other would be to surface custom comments, which all seem to be saying the same thing, which might prompt you to create a rubric comment.
So, right.
Mm-hmm. It could be used in both ways.
Yeah, excellent question. And of course I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that this is one of the big innovations of Gradescope for paper exams to allow clustering of similar answers. So now, so this is the scenario of a lot of things that are useful for an individual instructor and also with a group. And now we're going to look at a few specific workflows that work particularly well when you have a staff scenario. So staff scenario here, not that it's related to the fact that we have a staff, but just to sort of change our perspective a little bit. Now I'm going to show you what I can do if I have an existing rubric and how I can leverage that existing rubric. So we're grading an existing assignment. We have a pre-existing deductive rubric, and I am an instructor with a staff of TAs or staff of graders. So this is the rubric for the first assignment in Princeton CS1. The rubric was assembled mainly by Dan Laysberg and builds on work from the core staff. One of this semester's innovations that I really am happy about from Dan is that the rubric that we used to grade on 40 points, the CS2 assignments, and now our CS1 assignments, we grade them on 4 points because they're on the same normalization as exams. So we want students to really know what a point is worth in this course, and so everybody's on the same normalization scale, and we found that that's very successful at avoiding students overly quibbling on the points in an assignment. And that has really helped us shift the focus from grades, because if you have 40 points, all of a sudden every point seems to count, to feedback. So not everything is about the tool. Sometimes it's just about how you explain it and how you frame it for the students. So this rubric is still deductive. It roughly corresponds to our learning objectives in the course, in particular with code quality. So one of the assumptions that we can make is that this rubric can't really be changed. You know, you don't have the time to change this rubric. Maybe you don't have the hierarchy, you know, maybe you don't have the authority to make such a big change in a course. Or maybe it would offend certain of your colleagues that you replace their material. So we're going to show how to leverage this rubric to make it. So if your school does not give grades, then you're in this. This is an anonymous question. If your school does not give grades, then you're living in the future. We currently leave grades, but as you can see, our focus is less and less on grades. Like if I'm trying to move towards, you know, making the grades some a forlorn part of at least assignments. So that's something that CodePost also supports. You can also completely remove grade from the equation. And I think there's a panel, I don't know if it's still going on at SIGCSE, about how grades are terrible and we should move away from them. And there's a bunch of very smart people who will explain exactly why.
We have some users who, we have there's a setting in CodePost, which we can look at later, which Jeremy alluded to, which allows you to apply grades or apply scores to submissions, but then hide the scores from the students. And what that allows you to do is apply some structure, use the grades to track how students are doing without the other nasty part of the grade, if some people think is nasty, of the stack ranking component. And that's been I think people have enjoyed using it that way.
Thank you for the question. Yes, I agree with the question. Well, if you don't have grades, you should at least have micro-credentializing, so you tell the outside world who knows which part of the material. That's very true. But hopefully, all students that get through the course know the material. So we already have an existing rubric. This is the existing rubric. And so the first step of the process is to use the rubric editor to enter this rubric into CodePost. So the context, the rubric has been entered for the staff or graders to use. They can apply the rubric comments and optionally add their customization as we've discussed. And as I've discussed, for ownership purposes, for satisfaction purposes, they're encouraged to provide personal feedback as custom comments. Now to reset the context, we're not asking people to spend 40 minutes to an hour on every submission. We're asking people to use the left part of their brain maybe 3 minutes to actually read the student's code, to imagine the amount of effort that has gone into it, and to think of something unique to say about the submission. This is harder than it looks. I'm sure that you know this better than most people. But we found that by encouraging graders to try, we've really gotten a lot of really great things. So one of the things that I do with my graders is that I encourage them every week to submit a proudest comment. So that's a gamification concept. And there's a workshop on gamification tomorrow by the folk at West Salem State University. So we have them sort of think throughout their whole grading meeting about which comment they would be proudest of. And that really encourages every grader to do their best work and to give every student the highest level of consideration. So we've already shown how to audit custom comments, but rubric comments can also be checked. So applying comments from the rubric. So as I've already described, and as you'll be intimately aware after the walkthrough, when you have a rubric predefined, it appears with grader specific captions if available and is ready to be applied. So by the way, I'm not talking to you about the whole history of this, but of course, one of the steps in this process was for us to realize that having the same caption for graders and students was crazy, because the graders need something succinct that's easy to distinguish, and the students need something that's kind, patient, and pedagogical. And these goals are completely orthogonal, and it's why we've decided to split them. And since we've split them, everybody's happy, and we don't have to fulfill this impossible squaring of the circle. So in the grading console, you have the rubric window here highlighted. It lists all of the rubrics. It can be searched. It can be filtered according to category. Any part of the rubric can be searched. And then when you highlight code on the codes in the students, you can click in the rubric to apply that comment. So when a rubric comment has a deduction, instead of being in gray, it's in red. And when it has a bonus point, it's in green. So you can see here a rubric comment without customization. And below it, you can see a custom comment, which currently is empty. So that's the first step. Is graders will be grading, and they'll essentially be applying your rubric, and then also optionally applying custom comments. By the way, we'll discuss this, we'll mention this, you can restrict them to not be able to have custom comments if you do not want to give them at all any leeway. So then we go to the rubric explorer, which we've already mentioned previously. So previously we looked at explanations, but what we will be looking at now is the instances column. So when you click on the instances column, so for instance here, the 35 or the 57 or the 14, that will allow you to go into the rubric comment explorer. The rubric comment explorer allows you to see every single instantiation, every application of each rubric comment. So this allows you to look how this rubric comment was applied. So it allows you to see if a grader didn't apply a rubric comment. It allows you to see if a grader misapplied a rubric comment. So this is useful if you want to do it. You could assign some undergraduate students as maybe section leaders to audit this work, much like APCS grading. And then the second thing that I really find this useful to is that when I'm writing explanations, this is the first thing that I do. So my graders have applied this rubric that I didn't help build, that I'm not very familiar with. And my first step is going to understand how this rubric was applied to students. So I can do this by browsing for every important rubric comment. I'm going to go through and I'm going to explore what this looks like in a student's submission. So by clicking on the link here, which is the last column, I'm going to be able to see this comment in vivo in the student's submission. And by going through three, four, five submissions, I'm going to be able to see concretely, oh, this is what the student didn't understand. This is why they've been led to doing this thing. And this is how I can explain this to them in a way that's constructive. And then I spend 2 or 3 minutes writing my paragraph and the explanation, and I move on to the next rubric comment. So now that we've sort of looked at some broad strategy, I'm going to show you a couple other ways that you can use this. But essentially the idea is, once you are done grading, once you're done doing whatever it is that you were supposed to do to get your submission back to the students, whether it's providing feedback, whether it's auto-grading it, whether it's applying a rubric, what's really nice about CodePost is that we really try to expose all of the data that you've spent so hard to apply. We try to make it visible to you in many, many ways, to be able to slice it and dice it, and to sort of leverage the scale of your class in your favor. If you spent all of this time grading your class, you should be able to get some insights from it. You should be able to benefit from the fact that you have a huge class. And this is what being able to look at this data set is going to allow you to do. So this section is by no means exhaustive, but it's to try to give your minds thinking about all of the ways that you could explore what your students or graders are doing. And really, I want to say that I've been able to see that in the questions that we've seen, there's opportunities to help the students learn better, have them have better feedback, but there's also opportunities to improve how the graders understand and benefit from the grading process. So we want this to be interactive everywhere in all parts of this process. So one of the ways you can do that is iteratively. So there's several ways that the student can give you feedback. One obvious way is you can improve your rubric by soliciting feedback from students. This is something that we're still exploring. So this will allow you to catch unclear explanations. So for instance here, this is an example. My screenshot isn't recent, but this is in our first assignment, we had wrong format in the outputs. I think you've seen it in the example. And 23 students got this rubric comment. Now, you don't see the latest screenshot, so it has 4%. Since then, it has gone up to 8 or 12%. And meanwhile, an instructor had a student complain because they said, oh, it wasn't a requirement. This was noted nowhere. And this is something that has happened to us. Our assignments have evolved over 10 terms, over 10 years, actually. And the requirements have slowly changed in some places and not another. And we have sometimes this sort of whack-a-mole phenomenon where things are unclear in certain sections of our websites, but not in others. So this has allowed us to, just in time, do really high-quality customer service. You know, we made a call as a staff. No, you know, we didn't provide clear guidance to the students. It's not fair to be deducting this from them. So we're not going to make this a deduction, and we'll just tell students, thanks to their feedback, we made it a change of decision. That really helps engage the students in the process. Now, through this process, we've realized that thumbs up and thumbs down is really a first step, and we are thinking of better ways of getting feedback. So like asking students specifically, did this help improve your code? Did you find the explanation helpful? Did you find the explanation clear? So we're still exploring what kinds of things we would like to solicit from students to help improve the rubric.
And the goal here is just to make it as low friction as possible for the students to give you feedback on your feedback. Because if they have to, you know, email you, the number of students who are willing to email an instructor about the quality of the feedback they received is much fewer than the number of students who's willing to click a button to give you that feedback.
But you don't even need to. So James is really right to talk about low friction. So it really builds into my next point, which is as students have so many demands, there's so much, there's typical students have so much to do that you can't expect all of them to be engaging in this process, but they have a passive way of providing you information, which is just when you look at the rubric editor and you start having several terms of data, the distribution of the rubric is going to change because your teaching is going to change. So for instance, in past terms, many more students were using magic numbers in the second assignment. So in our teaching, it's really informed what we accentuate with students and how we explain things to students. We saw that in past term, it wasn't sufficient to tell them not to have magic constants. We need to explain to them better what those are, explain to them better why you want to avoid them. And we need to motivate this before the assignment and not after. All of these things seem obvious when I am able to distill them for you. But you know, when you have a lot of things to do, as we all have, it's really hard to think of all of these things. And these are insights that we're able to tease from this data. So one of the things that I did last term when I was doing these flipped class meetings and trying to tell students what they might want to hear insights about the grading process, I told them the mistakes that last term's class did. And I told them, you know, last time, because of our teaching, students made these types of mistakes. I expect that this term, especially because I'm telling you about this, you'll make different ones. And that's how we improve. So this term, because of what we've learned next term, the rubric that I've applied to these assignments has been a little bit more advanced. We've talked about a little bit more sophisticated things. You may think that, you know, talking about camel case is something that we've been doing at Princeton forever, but it's not. It's how our discourse has been improved by iterating what we deal with the rubric and what the graders are then able to focus in their customized feedback. So that's a very good question. Do you show last year's rubric comments just to graders only or also to students before exercises due? So typically at Princeton, the rubrics, just like the solution, are really secret material. But one of the things that I've been experimenting with, that we've been experimenting with more and more, is being more and more transparent with the students on what we do. So this term, for instance, which is new in COS 126 at Princeton, we have a style guide. So a style guide explicits all of the style deductions throughout the whole term. So we have a calendar. When we're going to start deducting for no comments, when we're going to start deducting for incoherent variable names. And we show this as a growing process so that students feel less like it's whack-a-mole, so they feel less like they couldn't have known this possibly ahead of time, and like we're just looking for things to deduct. We aren't yet releasing the full rubrics, but that's something that is currently in discussion, and we're experimenting with it with programming assignments. So we're going to release all of our rubrics for the programming assignments, both to show students that the rubrics are not, there's nothing special about rubrics. They're just a set of criteria. They don't measure a student's competence. They try to, but they are imperfect. And that's something that we really want to be straightforward for so that we can focus on the feedback. Do students feel like that feedback is anonymous? Does that make it a safe space for them to give feedback? That's a very good question. You know, part of the whole, one of the really big roles of design that the CodePost team, and informed by what I can witness with student, has done, is this is part of really the design. This is part of how you communicate to students. This is part of what you promise them. So for instance, a lot of effort has been made into explaining what the feedback buttons are about and what they're not, who gets to see them and who doesn't. So for instance, this data is meant to be aggregated and certainly not visible to the per student level. And for instance, that's where we draw the line in showing you all of this data set. We don't show you specifically what a student has answered in terms of feedback, or at least we don't intend to. And so we try to, just like I do with the anonymous questions, to have various tiers of engagement for students so that they can express exactly to how comfortable they are.
One anecdote here, when we released this feature, we actually received a lot of skepticism because a lot of our instructors expected students to rage vote, to downvote comments that took off points, essentially. And we were pleasantly surprised to find that that doesn't seem to have been the case. And my theory is that it's largely due to the fact that students recognize that these, and it's communicated to students that this feedback is really intended to help teach the next batch of students. And if you are rage voting, then you're decreasing the quality of data and making it harder for instructors to write good feedback. And so far, at least, it seems to be the case that there's a little relationship between the point value of a comment and the feedback score associated with it, the aggregate thumbs up, thumbs down score.
Yeah, absolutely. And all of that is of course part of the same mindset that the more opportunities you give to people to express themselves, the less pent up rage they feel that they have to express in non-constructive ways. The other thing that I want to emphasize here, especially since we were talking about multiple staffs, is that one of the big pain points that I've always had, that our staff has always had in this situation, where you have a rubric. How do you explain to graders what this rubric is about? And this is a pain point that we've had, especially when we've moved to many graders. So we can't tell grad students, oh, take 10 hours or however long you need to be familiar with this rubric. So how do you train graders to understand how to apply a rubric comment? Well, this is where the past terms of data becomes really effective, because for all of these tricky rubric comments, I can pick out an example for the graders. And in my first hour, you know, I was telling you about the teaching lesson. I can do a review of the really tricky rubric items, and I can show them how they've been applied in the past. And so that really facilitates how you train your graders, and it also provides you less excuses to not train them. Because, of course, one of the things that is often not said is that the quality of the grading work also depends to how much you invest in explaining to the graders what you want. We have the benefit of, for a lot of us, a PhD, a long experience teaching and assessing, and a lot of that experience becomes second nature to us. And there's a lot of things that we don't always know to explain, and that we don't realize that grad students or undergrads don't know. And so here, this is really a clear way to put everybody on the same page. So then there's a lot of things here that align to ensure fairness. So what does fairness mean for grading? It means avoiding conflicts of interest. It means consistently scoring. So we help avoid conflicts of interest with an anonymous grading mode. So the added benefit of removing unconscious bias from grading process besides explicit conflicts of interest. So this is a feature that I really take to heart. So if you notice in like all of the submissions that I've shown, I don't know if you'll get to see it, but yeah, so here in the top left, you can see anonymized. So this is now how we do things in 126. We've gone to full anonymization. This is something that is really important to me, and I'll tell you why, and I hope you won't judge me for it. But again, back in the day when I was grading CS2 and I was just starting my career, you know, in those 10 hours grading on Friday to try to get all of the submissions graded, by the end, I was exhausted. I was cranky. I was prone to cognitive biases. And I remember very specifically grabbing another submission from a pile of paper that seemed interminable, and a couple grad students had called in sick. And I looked at the name, that was the first thing that I did, and I thought to myself, oh, it's going to be hard to grade again. And I had a minute of self-reflection. I said to myself, now, wait a minute. Now, why do you think it's going to be hard to grade? You didn't look at the number of tests. You didn't look at any like metric. You just looked at the name. And I realized the name was of a female student. And that's when I said, oh, crap, that's not good. You know, that's a bias. And that's something that I need to work to avoid. But what this really means is that I don't want to have biases. I don't want to be unfair to any students. And if I am not fair, it's unintentional. But that's through a lot of work. It's through advocacy that I've received from this community. And not everybody that is grading for me necessarily has had the same experience and the same exposure. So the easiest way to avoid any question is full anonymization. That's something that we really support well. So then as to the second question, consistent scoring, well, there's two ways that it's a lot fairer. Since you can explore the rubric, you can explore how it's been applied. When you walk through CodePost, you'll see that you can look at the grader's average distribution of comments, the grader's average grade. So you can also look across graders, have the graded submission, and see if there are differences among graders that can't be explained otherwise. And then the other thing about fairness is that, as I explained with the feedback iteration, there's something particularly fair that at no point in your grading process is something, you know, can't be changed. So when you were grading with paper or PDF files or something, once something is graded or once it's out with the students, it's done. You can't change it. So if you've made a bad call, then everybody is stressed out. You have to explain to the students that it's a bad call. You have to chastise the graders that it made the bad call. And there's a lot of recrimination. There's a lot of blame. There's a lot of negative feelings. Whereas here, since everything is dynamic and everything can be changed, if there's a call that was made that was not optimal, you have ample time to revisit it. You have ample time to decide what is the best thing for everybody involved. And that really helps this be less stressful and be more productive.
Hey, I think we should take a break here just because we've been going for 90 minutes. But so why don't we reconvene at 8:45, 8:50 Pacific, and we can wrap up the one or two slides we have left in this section and then move on to the walkthrough.
Awesome. That's good.
Sorry that everyone online has to hear that there's cookies and coffee available. I too wish I had cookies and coffee at my disposal.
Maybe that's the next startup, virtual cookies.
I'm curious if any folks on the phone or on Zoom are teaching at institutions that have not moved online. Are any of you still teaching physical classes? Everyone's online. Or taking the most of their break. Break ends between 8:45 and 8:50, which probably means 8:50.
Thank you.
Hey, to the online folks, we're going to start this back up. Also, let me try having my screen face the room, so it feels more like you're talking to not a blank screen.
That would be so great.
I'll shut it down again. Give me a minute. All right, you good to go, James? Can you see the room?
Oh, very nice. Nice to see you, everybody. Yes, hi.
Well, this is so much better. Wow. Confirmation of your existence. This is great. All right, over to you, Jeremy.
Take us home. Yes, okay, so let me reshare my screen. Okay, so we were talking about ensuring quality. So we just talked, talking about mining the rubric data set. We talked about how to ensure fairness, and now I'm going to talk about how to ensure quality. So it's a hard problem. What makes good code review? So I would say that we talk about feedback quantity, lots of comments, but also about feedback quality, specific actionable reference student code, use rubrics. So that's a little bit trickier, and that's that versus more into explaining to the graders what their specific contribution to all of this is. And there are a couple ways that we can look at this. So first of all, to ensure quality, some of the best tools are the rubric comment explorer that allows you to look at what the graders have done, but also the custom comment explorer that lets you search through students' code. So those are the things that I've already talked about. And now I'm going to talk about two other ways to enforce quality. So the first way is the rubric only mode. If you don't quite trust or you don't want your graders to have any artistic license on the feedback that is provided to students, you can limit them to rubric only mode. In this case, they won't be able to create custom comments. They will be mandated to apply the rubric and customize it. The second way that you can improve the way that graders do apply rubric comments is by providing instruction text. So for instance, on your rubric, you have a rubric item for hard-coded constants. and you have an explanation for the student that explains why hard-coded constants are a problem. But then to make sure that the graders, all of the graders, connect this notion appropriately to the student's code, we can have instructions which appear in the bubble that the grader is going to fill that provides them guidance on what to write. So for instance, it would say, please explain to the grader how to define the constant and provide sample code and variable name, for instance. And so this is something where we can measure this with the CodePost API. So I'm going to talk about the CodePost API briefly, but first I want to take some of the questions. So first, a question that was related to the fairness and what I was telling you about biases, unconscious biases. There's a question that says, well, it is good to eliminate unconscious bias, but how being biased against a student because you see a really stupid quote unquote mistake in their code? That's a very, very good question. So the question is about, even if you eliminate any personal information, there can still be bias based on the patterns that a student is exhibiting in their submission. And I think that that's something that I'm not sure a tool can help with. Beyond, of course, the pretty printer, linter, and reformatting that helps avoid obvious formatting errors. By the way, pretty printers is why we don't have these unproductive conversations about braces anymore. Because that's all automated and everybody can pick what they prefer. But I would say that the way that we try to solve this problem is by communicating to the graders a sort of conduct, a sort of culture around code that when I talk about student code, I never belittle student code. I never say this student is wrong. I never say, I never say that that they should do something that they are unjustified. We always try to have a culture of respect. So now we come to the API SDK and beyond, and I'll just say two brief things about this. So first of all, CodePost has an open API. So CodePost has an open API and a Python SDK, and we'll have other SDKs as demand grows. And the point of that really goes back to the very beginning. You know, in the very beginning, I arrived at Princeton, wanted to improve things, but there was a lot of legacy things that I had to make peace with. I couldn't just change everything all at once. I had to integrate with existing rubrics. I had to integrate with existing autograders. I had to integrate with existing submission systems, existing LMS systems. And no tool is supposed to be a one-size-fits-all. What we really respect is individual choice, and that means that you should be able to combine this tool however you want it. You should be able to take whichever features you want and combine them with something else. And the only way to have something that works for everybody is to have an API, and that makes that easier. And before we conclude, I'd like to show you, just to echo what I was just talking about fairness, how I could use the API to audit what my graders have done. So I've written a script, and it's open source, it's on GitHub, that just looks at all of the comments that my graders have looked, and that tries to do some fine analysis. So it produces for every comment all of this data set so that I can later do something with it. So it has statistics down here on the ratio of the test passed of the code, whether the grader is using a rubric comment, whether the grader is discussing code, whether it's using Markdown to talk about code, and whether it's using the learner's variable names. So we're able to analyze the variable names that appear in the file. We're able to analyze the variable names that appear in the comment, and we're able to analyze the coincidence. So here, this student, this grader, commented on the student's code and discussed the student's variables. And that's very much what I was trying to have my students do, and I'm able to audit it dynamically. So I'm going to take a last round look at the questions, and then we're going to move to the interactive part of the workshop.
I can take these first two questions about CodePost. So the first question is, does anyone use CodePost for other rich response assignments that are not code-based? So for example, proofs in a discrete math course. The answer is yes. CodePost supports, it will correctly render markdown files, so students can submit rich content in that way, as well as PDFs. And the commenting interface, which we'll look at in the second half coming up right now, is very similar for markdown and PDFs. So we do have users who have students submit those file formats. LaTeX support is in the pipeline. Next question is about CodePost specifically is, will CodePost ever be open sourced? I don't know about ever, but it's not free in that sense right now. It is partially free in another sense, insofar as all the functionality that Jeremy has been talking about and all the functionality we're going to walk through in the second half of this workshop is available for free for higher educational use. So if you're worried about acquiring funds to use CodePost, or at least use the features that we're talking about, that's not an obstacle for you today.
And just adding on that, one of the things that I really believe is that quality software has to be paid. We were just talking in this whole talk, we were talking about incentives. What are the incentives of the students? What are the incentives of the graders? At some point, open source software is hard because there isn't somebody who's committed and has the incentives to maintain the software. So one of the things that we've seen a lot in the open source communities is that specific libraries, since 2008, the open source community has strived around libraries that have very specific purposes, but it's been harder to have software outlive without some sort of commercial support. And I think that Canvas is a really great example of how you can have synergy of both things. So I'm not quite sure what the question about Socratic comments means, but one of the things that you may see in the walkthrough is that, I think James wrote a blog post, correct me if I'm wrong, you wrote a blog post about this, right? Where we can have students have live office hours on CodePost, so they can submit multiple times and there can be like a real asynchronous or synchronous conversation around their code as well. I don't know if that answers your question.
Okay, I can share this blog post after the session.
So for now, what we're going to do is we're now going to share the slides with you, and we're going to share the walkthrough of the session. And now James is going to walk you through the walkthrough that we'll be giving you. And Vinay is going to walk through the room to help you with your own computers as you're following along. And of course, if you have any questions, you can ask them any way that you want, including on Slido, which we'll continue to monitor.
Awesome. So I've shared a link to a Google Doc on Zoom, and I'm about to email the official participants of this workshop with the same link.
And the slides, right?
I'm just sharing the walkthrough doc right now.
Okay.
If you don't fit into either of those categories, maybe raise your hand or let Vinay know, and he will get you this link. So I'll just pause to make sure everyone has the doc. Okay. Okay. So I'll just explain how this will work while Vinay makes sure everyone has the doc. So the document represents a walkthrough of some really basic CodePost functionality, as well as the features that Jeremy talked about. And the way I think we should try to do this is for me to project the steps through a screen share, and then for everyone else to follow along on your own computers. If anyone in the room has questions, let Vinay know, and he can come by your computer and help you out. If anyone on Zoom has questions, please ask those questions on Slido, and then we can have someone help you out in some fashion. So now I will share my screen and we can get started. Okay. Can everyone see my screen? Awesome. So just a quick overview of a reminder about CodePost. CodePost was a tool that was originally born at Princeton, as Jeremy mentioned, and since we've turned it into a company, and so we're used not just at Princeton anymore. Over 50 universities use CodePost to teach computer science. And like I mentioned before, the functionality we're going to walk through today is free for higher ed. So nothing you do during this workshop is behind a paywall. So for this walkthrough, we're going to focus on an example assignment called the birthday problem, which was originally written by Bob Sedgwick, who some of you may know. So you can just if we just pull up that assignment specification, let me pull it up. It's linked in the first part of the doc. I just want to orient everyone to what we're going to be doing. Does everyone see the birthday problem? I see lots of people flooding into the doc. Let me see if I can share it on my screen. Great. So really simple dummy assignment. What we're doing here is writing a Java class called birthday that's meant to teach students or simulate the birthday quote unquote paradox. So the assignment here involves writing a class called birthday with a single main method that takes in two command line arguments. One is a number, M, and the other is a name of a file. The file consists of just a list of space delimited integers ranging from 0 to 365. And the student's code is supposed to read these integers one by one and stop when it reaches an M collision. So if two is M, stops after finding two people with the same birthday, essentially. And once it stops, it's supposed to print out how many birthdays it read to find M occurrences of some birthday. So really simple CS1 level assignment. Okay, so back to CodePost. So the first step to get started with this walkthrough, so you can follow along, is to sign up for CodePost. So to do that from the home screen, you just click this big sign up button, and then this create course button, and then you can type in the email you want to use for your CodePost account, select your organization or create it if it doesn't exist, and then you can create your account. It's going to send you an email after you create your account asking you to set a password. So I'll just take like 45 seconds to let everyone do that before moving on.
Also, at any point, if you guys need help, just put up a hand. I'll come chase you down.
Someone just asked if I can share the Google Doc again. Oh, perfect. Thank you. Quick show of hands in the room to see how many people have got their accounts set up. Okay, that looks like most people. Okay, so let's keep going. Okay, so now that once you've got your account set up, you can log in. and you'll be taken to a page that looks somewhat like this, except you're not going to have a course here. And the first step in the walkthrough is to create a course. And you can do that by hitting this create course button up here, and then fill it in with whatever name you want. Period represents the period of your academic institution, so semester, quarter, et cetera. Great, so now we've got a fresh, clean course. What you see here, this is the CodePost admin console. This is where a lead instructor would basically set up and manage a course. So here you've got full read-write privileges to everything about the course. Do things like create assignments, add submissions, review submissions, edit your roster, et cetera. So moving on from step one to step two, one of the first things you're gonna do when you create a new course is add students to your course. So if we navigate over here to the students tab under the roster button, click add students, and this pop-up will ask you to add the emails of the students you want in your course. We use email as the primary key for students in CodePost. So you can put in whatever you want here, or you can just copy from the document. I pre-filled 5 students. Add that, hit review roster changes. It's gonna show you that, confirm you're adding 5 students. Confirm, boom. Now we've got 5 students in our course. And the next piece of groundwork we need to lay is we need to create an assignment. So I'll come over here, call this assignment birthday, and we'll make it out of 20 points. Now, CodePost is, we call it an end-to-end feedback tool. That means it handles students submitting code. It handles you reviewing their code, both manually and automatically, as we'll walk through here. There has some other course management functionality as well, including plagiarism detection, and it also allows you to return feedback to students. Now, in this example, because our students aren't real, we don't want them to submit, so I'm gonna leave the answer to this question right here. Do you want students to be able to submit to CodePost? No, but most people will check yes. And if you check yes, you get prompted to set a due date. But I'll leave it as no. Okay. Once you do that, you can X out of this. And boom, there's your assignment. Here's the birthday assignment. And it's missing 5 submissions because there are 5 students in your course and currently no submissions. Okay, I'll pause there. Any questions? I'll check slide view. Sorry, I've logged out of Slido, so I'm having to log back in. Someone asked, why don't we call it term instead of period? We probably could call it term. So someone asked, I can't see how to create an assignment. The way you get there is by clicking this overview button, and then that'll take you to a page that will look like this if you have an assignment in it, or it'll just have a big green button that says add assignment. Cool. Keep going. So this is the groundwork. We'll get to the interesting stuff soon. Am I being turned for a reason?
No reason.
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay, so next step, after we've created an assignment, we have to upload submissions to work with. Now, again, usually students will submit directly to CodePost, and I'll show you what that interface looks like. But for the purposes of this demo, we're just going to manually upload solutions. This feature exists as kind of a fail-safe in case, for some reason, students like email you code, or if you're forced to use a different submission mechanism like an LMS. Some institutions have policies that require this. So to upload submissions, you can come over here to the right of the assignments overview table, click the little button, upload submissions, and then multiple submissions. And what you're going to be asked to do here is drag in a folder that contains a bunch of subfolders with student emails and then the files within those subfolders. We've pre-created a folder for you of submissions for you to drag in that's available in the doc. Now, go find the submissions. Great, upload. Hit upload, it's gonna show you the submissions that are gonna be uploaded. So 5 students, we're uploading one file called birthday.java for all those students. And hit upload. Great. So now all the students have files. Okay, so I do, no questions, awesome. Okay, so now we're gonna do some interesting stuff. Who's ready to write some automated tests? So come over here and click the tests tab on the left and then the create button next to birthday. So this will pull up a little dialogue that's going to ask you to select your language. And if you click it, it'll show you a bunch of common languages that we support. We're doing Java, so hit Java. I bet I'm gonna get a bunch of questions on Slido now asking me if I support the specific language you teach in. The answer is yes. So the way CodePost does auto-grading is for every assignment, we create a Docker container for your assignment. And you have full control over what goes inside that Docker container. So if you select Java, we'll put Java into your container. But we also give you the ability to add whatever you want. So we can support the language of your choice so long as we can load it into a Docker container. Okay, so once you've selected Java, you see a few things pop up. Let me explain what these things are. So first thing is the run script. So you might be asking, well, this is Java. How do we make sure the student code compiles? So that's the job of the run script. So the run script is just a little code snippet that gets run before you run any tests. So if you select Java as your language, we pre-fill the run script for you with just a little bash snippet that runs Java C on all codes, on all code in your all student code. So that'll take care of compiling the birthday.java file for us. Next, helper files. So in order to test the student code, we're going to upload a file that looks like, that actually is exactly like this, 20birthdays.txt. This will just make the file available to the student code so the students don't all have to upload it. So I'll do that, add files. Birthdays. Awesome. So now I've added the helper file. Last thing is I'm going to add some solution code. Adding solution code isn't actually required for writing tests, but it's really convenient because it gives you a way to make sure to test your tests, to make sure your tests are working or passing on code that you expect them to pass on. So we'll go ahead and add some solution code. I think this is correct. I'll pause there. So just to recap, we selected Java as our language. CodePost set up a container for us with Java inside of it, created a run script for us that's going to compile the student code and our tests. I added a helper file because this assignment involves reading from a file. And then I added solution code that'll allow me to test our tests. Okay. Got some messages. I'm just checking. Okay, now we're ready to write some tests. So to write some tests, we're gonna go here, click on the test tab next to the environment tab. And here, we'll start off by creating a category. So CodePost tests in CodePost are two-tiered. Test cases are nested under test categories. So we're just gonna write some very simple correctness tests for this assignment. So we'll call this category correctness. Great. And then we'll click this green button here to add a test, our first CodePost test case. Now let me go back to the assignment specification. So here are three examples showing what we want the student code to do. Let me increase the font, or I'll zoom in so people on Zoom can see what I'm talking about. So when we run Java birthday 2 on 20birthdays.txt, we expect the student code to produce a string that looks like this. And we're gonna write a test to assert this. So go back to CodePost. For this, we're going to use the most basic test type in CodePost, and that's called an input-output test. There are a few different types of tests in CodePost. We'll walk through a couple of them in this walkthrough. The most simple is the input-output test. This is what you use if you just want to assert that the student's function on some parameters returns the right thing. And because this class only has one method, and it's the main method, we're going to run a command line input output test. So I selected command line here. Now I'll just run Java birthday 2 20birthdays.txt. So the test is going to run this command for me. And then it's going to look to see, to compare the value that's produced by this command written to standard output to the value I put in this box here. So what am I expecting? I'm expecting this string. So I'll put this string in. And then I can come down to this terminal-like thing here and I'll hit run. What this is gonna do is it's gonna test my test on my solution code. So I'll hit run. And it passed, which is what I wanted. So just to recap, you can see what this test is doing if you look at the pseudocode here. So it's running Java birthday to 20birthdays.txt. It's making sure it equals this string. We just went through a lot, so I'll pause, check out Slido, and let Vinay answer any questions in the room. But I just want to point out that we just created a simple input-output test in like 10 seconds, which I personally think is really cool. I'm just answering some folks' questions on Zoom.
There's someone who's asking about white space.
I suspect this question has been planted. So, a really good observation about this type of test.
I just want to highlight that it was not planted.
A really good observation about this type of test, that they seem quite brittle because we're asserting that the student produced a precise string with precise case, with precise white space, when all we really care about is that the student's code produces a 7 here, a 2 here, and a 101 here, right? If they use weird capitalization or weird white space, we don't really care. So one thing, one way you can say that I don't care about those specificities is by clicking here and selecting constant flex instead of constant strict. What this is going to do is it's going to assert the same thing, but ignoring case and ignoring white space. This is really useful when you have students produce strings.
So actually, I'll say that coincidentally, when this exam was graded a couple weeks ago, this is where I realized that the grad student who'd implemented this solution had misspelled occurrence and had only one R. And I found it because the solution code was failing the test that I thought it should be passing.
We made this when we saw so many people writing tests to in via the next type of test, which I'll show. And so we wanted to make an easier way to do it. There is an even more expert level way to write this test, which is to specify a regular expression instead of a string. And so what this will do is it'll do what you expect. It'll make sure the student's output matches the regular expression. So I think I put the right regular expression in the doc. So here, if I put this regular expression, it's going to compare the student's output, or in this case, our solution output, to that regular expression. And I think it should work. Great. And so here, I'm just really capturing the correctness element of the test. OK, let's keep going.
Could you show an example when it fails?
Yeah, sure.
And of course, as I think you've said, James, you can run this on the solution code, but also on any submission if students have uploaded them.
Yeah, I'll show that. So here is just, I want to point out the syntax for what it looks like when a test fails. So it'll show you what it expected and what it got. And as Jeremy mentioned, this terminal allows you to test your tests on both solution code as well as any student code that's been uploaded. So a pattern we see often is instructors will take a look at some student code, will assess visually that there are some problems with it, or they'll run it themselves and assess that there are problems with it, and then they'll write tests to identify those problems. And when you're doing that, ways, the first way is to make sure it passes on solution code. The second is to make sure it fails or correctly identifies the problem in specific submission. And so you can do that by selecting that submission here, indexed by the name of the student or the email of the student. So if I select this and hit run, it's going to run the test on that student's submission. OK, so just to practice, why don't we go ahead and have everyone write tests for these two assertions. So when we run java birthday 3, 20 birthdays.txt, we expect this string. And when we run it with 4 and 20 birthdays, we expect this string. So you can just use the same input output style. I'll go ahead and do that now. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Ed, can you hear me?
Yes.
Were you able to upload the files, or are you still having
a
problem with
No, that? I had two things. I tried two things. I tried to take it from the downloads folder and then drag it into upload, and although it appeared to drag it, it wouldn't take it. And then I clicked in the folder and tried to search downloads, but for some reason it was only showing the files, or actually only the directories that were uploaded, that were downloaded a long time ago. So I couldn't find it either way, and I just got stuck there.
So what email could you type? Could you tell me which email you're using?
Hey, Jeremy, we can all hear you. I'm not sure if you realize that.
Okay. efg@ncsu.edu. I'm not sure that we want to make everybody hear us, right?
And Jeremy, would you be able to assist Ed, maybe via chat?
Yeah, that'd be fine.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks. Okay, great. So now we've created these few tests. We're through with the first section. So now we can move on to exploring some of the strategies that were discussed in the first part of the workshop. So the first part of part two, we're going to talk about creating those level one requirements, which we talked about. So again, level one requirements are the tests that essentially check for compilation and API specification to make sure that student code is going to be more easily reviewable and testable. So we'll start off by creating those two tests. So I'll create a category called level one. And then I'll create a test in that category. And I'll call it compile check. Okay. So for this test, we're going to use a different test type, slightly more advanced test type. We're going to use bash, unit test type bash. And what this is going to allow us to do is essentially write a small bash script to run our test. So the way these tests work in CodePost is you can write any bash you want. To report the results of the test, you use this little command here called test output. This is a CodePost custom bash command. And it's really simple to use. You just give it two arguments. The first is true false, which indicate whether the test passed or not. And the second is any logs you want to append to the test results. So what we want to do is we want to write a test to make sure that the student's birthday.java file compiles correctly. So all we have to do there is write effectively one line of bash. Try to do java c birthday.java. If that passes, I want to assert the test passed, and if it doesn't return successfully, then I want to assert that it failed. So if it returns successfully, I'm going to call test output with the first parameter true to indicate the test passed. I'll say compiled. And otherwise, I'm going to report that the test failed. So this one line of bash constitutes our test to make sure that the student's code is compiling. And now I'll run that on the solution code and it better work. Nice. That was our first unit test in CodePost. I guess I'll pause there. Let me check a slide. Okay. Time for our final test. And what we're going to do here is we're going to write a simple test to verify the API of the birthday.java class. So we'll create another test, level one requirements, and we'll call it, what did I say in the document? I didn't give a name. API test. And for this test, we're going to select test type unit test Java. And so here, the idea is very similar to the bash unit test, except you're writing Java, not bash. And because you're writing Java, instead of calling the test output command, you return a test output object. Same idea though, two parameters. First parameter indicates whether the test passed. Second parameter is the logs you want to attach to the test. Okay, so instead of, sorry, my AirPods have just failed. Can you still hear me?
Yes.
Great. Okay. So instead of writing this test from scratch, for the sake of time, you can just copy the code that's in the doc. So this code uses everyone's favorite feature of Java, reflection, to test to make sure that the birthday.java class contains a main method. So I just copied and pasted the code from the walkthrough doc into the unit test. Okay, let's run that. We know this is going to work because we've been running the main method from the input-output tests. Great. And this code is pretty easily extensible if you wanted to check for other methods or check to make sure certain methods are not defined. But the main point I want to communicate here is this is just Java. And in the bash test, this is just bash. You can write whatever you want to execute on student code so long as you use that test output syntax. Okay, last thing here. I mentioned during when we were talking about level one requirements that it's really useful to expose these tests to students at the point of submission so that they can get immediate feedback and hopefully correct mistakes which are leading them to fail these tests. So in CodePost, you have really fine-grained, you have the ability to expose certain tests but not others to students at the point of submission. So you could choose to expose these level one requirements to students but leave these correctness tests unexposed. They're all going to run when students submit, but the students are only going to see the exposed ones. So I'm going to expose these tests. Now we don't have any real students in our course, but I'll just show you what it looks like for students to submit. I think I linked a video in the doc as well that you can watch. But something a lot of instructors do when they're setting up their courses is they'll add themselves as a student so they can understand the student experience. So I'll add myself to my course. And I'll just configure this assignment to make it possible for students to submit. Set a due date. Now I'll go check it out. So this is the CodePost student console. Just want to give you a quick preview of this. Basically what students can do in CodePost is submit code and receive feedback. So here, if I hit view assignment, I can submit code for the birthday assignment. So I'll go over here, find birthday.java, hit upload. And now CodePost is going to run those two tests that I exposed, and the student is going to get feedback immediately. So I can see I passed those two tests. Okay, back to the admin console.
So now we wrote those tests, I'll just show you how to run them on the student code. So come back here to the test tab, hit results, and then come up here and you can hit run all tests. What this is gonna do is it's just gonna run all the tests you wrote on all the students. Shouldn't take too long. But I realize I've committed myself to however long it takes.
By the way, this is very cool to see when you are running 30 tests over a class of 300. Like, it has all these weird shapes take place.
Yeah, this motor right here is supposed to make it more fun to wait for lots of tests to run. And it also is actually quite useful in the event that, let's say you wrote a test and you didn't follow best practice and tested on solution code, that very well could show up here because you might see it failing in 100% of cases. Okay, so it's done. The CodePost autograder, again, is running all of the student code and the test code on our servers and containers. Again, this is part of the free tier for higher education. And it's pretty, it seems to be pretty, the speed is acceptable for most use cases. If you are running an enormous course and running, you know, hundreds of tests, you might want something faster, and that is part of our paid tier. So we do offer faster auto grading. But this level of speed is very much within the free tier. Okay, so now we've run these tests, we can start looking at some of the techniques around code review that we discussed earlier. So I'm just gonna open up a submission in CodePost and show you just the basics of code review. So to get to the submission, I went to the assignments overview tab, hit the 6, and then just picked a student. So this is the CodePost code console. This is where you can do code review in CodePost. So pretty simple. Here's the student's code. It's just one file. If I click here, I'll see the results of the tests that I ran and wrote. So here are the 3 correctness tests. Here are the 2 level 1 requirements. They all passed in this case for the student. And the basic idea here is if you want to make a comment on student code, you just highlight and then leave a comment. And you can include markdown in these comments too. If you want to take off a point, that's really easy. Add a point, same. This is the original functionality in CodePost, just code annotation. I'll pause there to let everyone catch up. So someone asked on Slido. Oh, I see it's already been answered, but I'll read it for the group. So someone asked on Slido, does claim another submission randomly select another submission? I think here you're referring to the grader console, is that correct? Well, if you're referring to the grader console, we'll actually showcase that functionality in like 2 minutes. Okay. So now I'll talk about some of the rubric functionality that Jeremy was walking through. So you can build a rubric in CodePost using this rubric element over here. So it's really easy to build a rubric as you go. For example, you might want to create a rubric comment to comment on a student's use of magic numbers. So I'd create a category here called style, create a comment, and just call it magic numbers. And remember, in the tag then explain model, we don't need this comment to be verbose or pedagogically helpful. We're just trying to create something that we can use to tag student code so we can explain this concept later. So I'll save my rubric, then I can select a line and just click the rubric item to apply it. And now this comment applies the rubric item. And if I want to, I can add that personalization text that Jeremy was mentioning. And so we would now, if we were actually grading these submissions, we would go through and we would use this comment on all the submissions. Once we're done, we come back here to the admin console, hit rubrics, hit edit, and now you're going to be taken to a new editor that's specifically dedicated to the rubric. And here, Jeremy was showing a lot of screenshots that looked at this page. What this page allows you to do is a few things. One, you can click and see where you're, see the distribution of your rubric comments, where they've been applied. So I only applied this rubric comment once. And I can see that here. And you can also add the explanations that Jeremy was discussing. So if I hit settings, show explanation editors, now I can spend as long as I want explaining why magic numbers are suboptimal to students. And when students view their feedback, they're not going to see a comment that says magic numbers. They're going to see this explanation. And what's nice about this is this explanation just propagated to all the places where I used this comment. So that's explanations. That was section 2.1 in the walkthrough. I think we'll skip section 2.2 just for the sake of time. So moving on to section 2.3, turning on student feedback. So student feedback is the thumbs up, thumbs down voting that we looked at in the first half. It's actually on by default because we want to nudge all of our users to use it. If you want to confirm that it's working, you can always come here to the code console, hit this button on the top right called what a student will see. And this will show you what the submission looks like for a student. And you can see here it has these two buttons. So when a student is viewing their feedback, their comments will look like this. And they can leave feedback by clicking one of these buttons.
Note that you can't game the system. I think if you try to click on it as an admin, it will prevent you from doing it.
Yeah, you shouldn't be voting on your own feedback. We should look at our logs to see if anyone's tried to do this. Okay. And as we pointed out earlier, this feedback is summarized in the rubric editor. So I don't have any students, so no one's voted. But that those numbers would show up here. And again, it's aggregated. So you can't see, you can't hover over these and see who's voted in what way. Okay, that's rubric comment feedback, section 2.3. And in the last 10 minutes or so, I just want to show you how to incorporate graders into a course on CodePost. So we actually have a totally separate user model for graders. An admin, as I mentioned, can do has full read-write control over a course. Graders have much narrower permissions. Essentially, what a grader can do is review submissions. They can't add students. They can't upload submissions. They can't, by default, create rubrics. So if I want to add graders to my course, it's just like adding students. I'd come over here. I'm a grader. By default, I can add more graders. Like that. And in CodePost, graders get their own console. So this is what the grader console looks like. It's much more minimal. And the way grading works by default in CodePost for graders is the is using this concept of an ungraded queue. So if I hit claim here, it's just gonna give me a submission that hasn't been graded. And it's my job to grade it now. So I can go in and review it just like I would, just like I was showing earlier. And what's really nice about this model is it means if you don't want to, you don't have to manually map graders to submissions and say, hey, you grade submission 1, 2, 3, you grade submission 4 and 5. You can just say, hey, everyone, you need to grade this many submissions, and then they can go and click the button however many times.
I'll say that this is one of the things that makes grading faster at Princeton, is that you can also say, I have a room of graders and just keep grading until there's no more submissions left. And that means that you even out the cost of difficult submissions and easy submissions across all graders, as opposed to assigning a specific number to each and then letting some graders grade really quickly and others really slowly.
Okay. And while we're here, I thought I'll show off a cool feature that we recently merged. One request we were getting a lot was, hey, I see my student failed a test and I want to figure out why. So I'd like to be able to edit the student's code, fix a few things, and rerun the tests. And that's what this allows you to do. So this is just like a very lightweight IDE. We're not in the IDE business yet. But you can just edit this code in any way you want and rerun the tests. And what this allows you to do is just confirm hypotheses about why the student is failing tests. So that's a nice feature we just added. So now that we've learned about graders, I'll just mention a few of the features that were discussed with respect to graders. So if you want graders to be able to contribute to a rubric, in other words, you don't want to build it all yourself, there's a setting for that. It's called collaborative rubric creation. And similarly, if you want to add some of the settings that Jeremy was talking about, you can do so from this page. So if you want to make grading anonymous, you do that from here. If you want to force graders to use a rubric, you do that from here. So I'll just showcase what a submission looks like with anonymous grading and rubric-only mode turned on. So now the student's name is anonymized. Because I'm an admin, I'm able to reveal it. Don't worry, graders don't have this ability. So if your goal is to truly hide the identity students from graders, anonymous grading mode will do that for you. And then we're in rubric only mode. So if I try to create a custom comment, it's going to say, hey, you have to link a rubric comment first. And then once I link a rubric comment, now I can customize it. So those are a few of the cool features we've added to make it easier to manage a team of TAs / graders. Thanks for bearing with me. That's the entirety of the walkthrough.
We show the edit code.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, how to get there. What's that? Can you explain how you get to edit?
Oh, what a great question. We just added so we were getting fed up with our UI in the code console because it was getting so cluttered because we were adding so many features. So we don't think it's too cluttered now, but you know, in previous iterations, we had like many buttons up here at the top, and it was just getting confusing to access all the cool functionality we were adding. So what we've done is we've added this thing that you can access by hitting this little search bar in the top left, or by hitting Command K if you're on Mac, or Control K if you're on Windows. We're calling it our foo bar because it's a bar. And essentially, it allows you just to execute actions. So to get to the edit code feature, I just typed in edit code, and then I hit return. But it's pretty nice having this feature because, or this foobar thing, because it's a nice kind of default action to take. If you're not sure how to do something, you can just type, like, if you're not sure how to, I don't know, finalize a submission, you can just type finalize and it'll hopefully show you something. So when in doubt in the code console, hit Command K and just type.
So of course that's part of a set of features that we didn't quite have the time to go into that encourage the use of the keyboard, because the less graders have the context switch between mouse or trackpad and keyboard, the faster they are.
And I think I forgot to mention a feature which I consider one of the most important in CodePost, which is dark mode. But I hope this saves you some eye strain. Thank you guys for coming to our workshop. We really appreciate it. Hope you found it useful, and we'll stick around for a few minutes for any questions. Thanks a lot for sticking with us.
Yeah, thank you very much, everybody, for sticking with us.
Also, we have a booth here tomorrow, so if you guys want to stop by and hang out with me, I welcome to. The rubric. So, So James, the question was, when you highlight code and you put in text, it's a tag that later gets replaced with the font. I believe this is that you're showing the explanations.
Yeah, good question. So I think we created an explanation for this comment. Let me confirm. So to see, whenever you have a question of the form, what does a student see, you can answer it by hitting this button.
Oh, sorry. Your face is blocking that button.
Oh, sorry. This button.
What to see what a student sees.
And I think, yeah, so let's toggle between the two. So this is how the comment looks to you, magic numbers. And then if we look at how it looks to the student, sorry, my Zoom control panel is getting in the way. It says this is an explanation. And that's because we created this explanation earlier. So students will never see rubric comments that have an explanation. They'll only see the explanation.
There's a question in the Slido that I answered in the Slido, but might be interesting for everybody is, if I claim but have not done my job. So I'm interpreting the question a little bit. So if I'm not answering it correctly, please correct me or ask it again. But I think that the person is asking, what happens when a grader claims a submission but doesn't grade it or doesn't finalize it? That's a very good question. It happens in practice every week that a few graders forget to finalize or forget to grade a submission that they have claimed. CodePost makes this easy after it being a pain for instructors like myself, which is that there's a button in every assignment where when you click it, it sends a reminder to all the graders that haven't finalized submissions and nudges them to do something, either release the submission if they don't feel qualified to grade it, if it's a really weak submission. So James is showing this button right now. So it's in the statistics, and you can send an email to yourself.
In this case, I'm the only grader. it doesn't exclude you.
So again, this is part of the features to reduce the friction. So it's not, you don't have to reach out to the graders manually. Yeah. Thank you for the question.
Anything else? Any questions? Yes. Yeah, good question. So the question was, can you run JUnit tests? James,
That sounds like a you question.
Okay, sure. I'll speak close to the microphone. So what we showed to you is kind of a way to write tests in an easy way, unit tests. But CodePost also has a functionality called file mode, where you can, from the test interface, run arbitrary scripts. It dumps the outputs to a file that shows up in the student's submission. So we actually have a help doc that will show you how to run JUnit tests. What you essentially do is you upload your JUnit test as a helper file, and then you just run file mode to run the same commands you do on your computer. And all the JUnit outputs get dumped to a file that'll show up at the student submission. Instead of seeing the structured tests that you see when you write CodePost unit tests, you'd see a file that's called tests.txt that shows the output of those. So more generally, even outside of JUnit, if you already have existing test scripts, you don't really want to port it over to CodePost tests, even though there are benefits like exposing tests and attaching points or whatever, you can just dump your scripts and run them out.
This goes back to the design of the autograder. It's just a container. And when you run code in it, it's just normal code. So the test interface that we showed you in this demo, which Vinay was talking about, that's just kind of a syntactic sugar on top of the container. And if you use it, you get some benefits, like you can attach points to tests. But if you're like, hey, all I want from you guys is just the container, I just want to run stuff in it, and I want to print, which is probably what your normal test scripts do if you already have written them, you can just run them in this interface. So I won't show you how to do it, but there's a lot of documentation that'll walk through it.
One of the things also that you will notice once you start using CodePost is that the autograder is scaffolded, which means that all of the tests, the template tests that are provided to you, directly have an impact on the files, and you can switch back and forth to see what CodePost is doing. And that helps you integrate our test templates with whatever you are doing as well.
The question is about the API. Would you mind pulling up the documentation?
Was the question, is there an API?
He said, I heard there was an API.
Ah, great. Oh, that's it. I was really hoping someone was give us the opportunity to show this off. So yes, there is an API. So basically every piece of data you see in CodePost is accessible via the API and is attached to some CodePost object. So the course, that's an object. An assignment, that's an object. Submission, object. Comment, object. And so if any operation you can dream up that would involve those objects, you can execute via our API. And if Python is your language of choice, you can use our convenient SDK. So I don't know, this is probably not legible. Should we do some live API coding?
If you're feeling up for it.
Is this generally of interest?
All right, yeah, we got a few nods.
Oh man, okay. Whew. Let's do it. Okay. Let's do it. Give me 1 second to share my terminal. Okay. Wow. Best screen share ever, just a terminal. This is awesome. Can you guys see this? Yeah? Can you see my terminal? Great. So I'm gonna boot up Python. I have our package installed. So if you wanna do this, if you wanna follow along, you can do it too. Just pip install CodePost, and that will install our Python SDK for you. So I'll open up Python, I'll import CodePost, and now I'll showcase just a few basic operations. So first, I'll authenticate. Oops. So codepost.configurAPI key, and API key is accessible from your settings as a user. If you want to grab that, it's with the little gear button to the left of the logout button. Vinay can show you if you're having trouble finding it. So I just copied my key. Don't worry, this is a service account. So, okay, so now I've authenticated. So I want to grab the courses that are available to me. So I'll just do codepost.course. Oh man, I'm forgetting the syntax. I knew this was gonna happen. But I can grab it from our docs. codepost.course.listavailable. Okay. So this is probably hard to read. So let me just grab the first one. This is a course object. So you can see it has an ID, it has a name, it has a period. And if I want to, I can set these properties using the API. And this is just one of any many objects that you can access with the API. I'm trying to think of something that would be cool to demonstrate. Why don't we create this assignment via the API? So to create an assignment, all I have to do is the following. Man, I've never done this in a demo before. This is really stressful. Okay. So I'll create an assignment like this, codepost.assignment.create. And then if you're following along the API docs, there are only a few properties you have to specify to create an assignment. One is the name. The other is the number of points. And then I'll specify the course. And let's see, which course do I want? I want this one. Boom. So now I just created the assignment. And if I go back, I'm going to switch windows and should prove to you that it was created.
He's quickly creating it. your window's still on the terminal.
I know. I'm trying to switch.
What screens do you have open?
I have many screens. We're all learning how to use Zoom together. Voila! Hello world.
API. We actually have a public repo that a lot of our users use and contribute to itself, of scripts that they build on top of the API for things that they think are pretty cool. For example, there's some scripts for certain languages on how do you do some parsing and syntactic parsing for certain languages. I think some folks have also written scripts about like creating heat maps of rubrics by graders and stuff like that, like analytics and dashboards.
I would say two of the most common use cases for the API are, number one is automating integrations. So some folks prefer to have students submit somewhere other than CodePost for whatever historical reasons. And it's trivial with the API to create submissions as long as you have access to a student's code. So just like I just created an assignment, you can create a submission and you can create files. So that's a very common use case, is pulling submissions from somewhere else into CodePost. And another common one, which Jeremy alluded to in his section, was just pulling comment data out of CodePost and parsing it.
Yeah, so I also wanted to show an example. One of the things I would recommend whenever using the API is to use a Jupyter notebook. We support Jupyter notebooks, of course, very well, and this allows you to get the syntax of provided to you. So, for instance, here list available by doing shift tab, you can get the list of parameters. And when we haven't been renegades and have provided a doc string, you can get the documentation for that as well. So as we've discussed, there is comments analytics that you can do. There's all sorts of things that you can do. But one typical example that I'd like to show is that often you find yourself having made a terrible mistake that affects a subset of the submission. So one example is a couple weeks ago, we uploaded submissions that were incomplete, that students had not yet completed. And so the graders were starting to grade submissions that were only partially complete and that were very weak. Fortunately, all of those submissions contained the word not done.
Hey, Jeremy, I think we're being told we need to wrap up.
Okay.
All right. Awesome, guys.
Sorry, the fun's over. Thank you all for joining us. Really appreciate it. If you have any questions about CodePost, definitely let us know.
Please do. Thanks, guys.